So I wonder if you know all the different people that have been involved in the ministry this year, and I'll just introduce them, and at some point I'll probably say their name, and if you hear your name, we would like for you to stand just to be recognized, and then once everybody's standing, we'll maybe give a little round of applause as a way of saying thank you, and then that'll be my part. Of course, the minister is Roger Thompson. I guess most of you realize that. So there he is. He's the good-looking fellow that takes care of everything here. I'm the associate pastor, and then we have Harvey Bradbury, who is an elder, among many other things. Now, the three of us serve as elders here. Now, our desire is to have many more elders, and someone suggested the idea is, well, how do we have more elders? Well, one of the ways that we would appreciate is we welcome recommendations. You know, people you think, you know, as I've been observing, I really appreciate this person. And so we take very seriously the role of elder, and 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1 sort of define what that is. So I encourage you to share names of people that you think are on that way. Let's see, the treasurer is Scott Allison over here, and I should have Donna stand with him because she serves also. Your name's down here, Donna, as Stewardship Ministries. So we need someone to keep Scott in line, so you're the person. So that's good. Harvey also serves as the financial secretary, working together with Scott and Donna. And Scott also serves as a trustee. We also have Roland Davis back there. He teaches an adult Sunday school class. He's a trustee. So these are very trustworthy men, I might add. Then we have what is called the, well, Roland's also head of the Adult Education Ministries. I should add that as well. We have what is called a benevolence ministry. This is where if people do have a difficult time, we're available to help. And so we have some people overseeing that. And for a long time, it was Mary and Ken Clufa. So Mary, you get to stand on this one. Okay. And if it gets too tired, you just go ahead and sit back down again there. But you don't look old. That's the thing about that. And who's taken that over has been John and Dana Galbraith, which I assume are out of town today. Yeah. It's Cooper's up here representing them. And then I oversee, discipleship ministries. Then we have children's ministries, and the people in charge of children's ministries are doing them, looks like. So they're not here. That's Connie Thompson is oversees that ministry with the help of Amy Thompson as well. We have a very important ministry because it deals with something dear to our stomachs. That's the hospitality ministry. Shawnee does a great job organizing that. We appreciate her. She also oversees when we have a funeral or something like that, any kind of special occasion. And our meal today is being organized and overseen by Shawnee. Then as far as the missions ministry, we've had a transition. The lady who was heading that up for a while was Kathy Tummins. And Kathy's back there. You can stand, Kathy. And she turned it over to Jason Moyer. And Jason, if you would like to stand, and he's now heads up the missions. And I believe we have like seven missionaries that we're supporting currently. Then we had property ministries, and that was also transitioned this year. The man who did it in the first part of the year was Bob Schnurr. And Bob, can we get you to stand there? And Bob did a great job and still continues to be available. And then we asked Nick Ritzer to take it over, and has a team of men, and they have just done an outstanding job already fixing different things, and we sure appreciate their ministry here. And then stewardship ministry, if you talked about that, and then of course we have worship ministry. Where's Nathan? There he is back there. So Nathan also heads up the young adult ministry. So these are all the different workers at Northwest Christian Church. So would you like to just give them a thank you for all their service they've done here? And you can all be seated there. Thank you. We appreciate you. And I've oftentimes said, you know, sometimes we make a big to-do of people who are elders or pastors and so forth. And you think, well, they have the important jobs. Let me tell you just try to get by without all these other support people, and a church sure doesn't last very long. So we appreciate you all. Harvey.
Hey, let's talk about money real quick. Scott and Donna are the ministry team leaders for the stewardship team. Make this quick. There are some financial challenges here at Northwest when it comes to our financial resources. We firmly believe, though, that nothing is too big for the God we serve. Nothing. We were not sticking our heads in the sand, but we had to look at the financial situation, where we were at, where we're going, everything. We decided not to cut budgets. We had to contemplate whether or not we were going to lay off staff members. We decided not to lay off staff members. We decided by faith that we trust that God will provide, solely by faith. When I say we, I mean me and all the staff, Roger, Philip, Nathan, Megan, the stewardship team, Scott and Donna, and several others. We honestly feel in the pit of our heart that there are great things going on here at Northwest Christian Church. There are things going on that God has ordained, and there are things that he is going to bless, and may I say bless richly. So we didn't cut the budget, and we didn't lay off our pastors or our staff. For God we serve is an amazing, wonderful, loving God. He will provide. Gentry, you got some charts up there? All that. But don't get scared by any of these charts. Fear is a tool of the devil. And we serve an amazing God. This is just a chart real quick to show you. All this is a quick little chart to show you. The general fund offering through the year of 2016, every week. That shows you, I mean, it's just all over the place. But that is an average there of about $4,600 every Sunday. So that's every Sunday. Next chart. This is actually in your, a portion of this one is actually in your annual report. This shows, first, the mortgage balance on this building, this property, is sitting at just over, at the end of 2016, at just over $30,000, which is not a lot of money in the scheme of things. We are praying by faith that at the end of this year, it is zero. That shows you the year-to-date contributions and the year-to-date expenses. And it shows that our expenses were running about $25,000 more than the contributions. Which is, that's the situation that led to all the, you know, we had a ministry moment back in, I don't know, September, October time frame, just to try to be transparent, try to give you guys an understanding of where the church is at financially. So last year, we ran $25,000 in the hole. Next. This shows you a picture of the checking account balance. From January 1st here on the left at a little over $40,000. And where we ended up the year, right the same. If you remember the same chart, or a similar chart, I said that line was pointing straight towards that guy. This one does too. So he's going to take care of that again, just like I said. But right now, at the end of 2016, the balance in the checkbook was about $8,600, but a little over $8,000. Okay? But might I just add, every need was met, every bill was paid, every payroll was made, our needs were met. Missionary supported, benevolence needs handled, met. Okay? Next. This is the money market account, savings account. And the balance in that right now, at the end of the year, and right now too, is just a little over $26,000. Okay. We did not have to dip into that to pay any bills. in that $26,000 savings account or money market account, included in that is Great Commission Fund, the missions and the benevolence. 15% of every Sunday's offering goes into the Great Commission Fund. That gets split then, 10% of that, so 10% of your total Sunday offering goes into missions, 5% into benevolence. At the end of 2016, the account balances in those accounts for the missions was at about $4,000, and for benevolence was at about $11,000. There any more slides? Awesome. Good. We've seen enough slides. Do not be scared of what you saw. Understand that we have an opportunity. We have an opportunity to bless God with our resources. And I can guarantee you one thing. He will bless us when we bless Him. So, if you have any further questions, want any more additional information, I got way too much of it. Scott has way too much of it. We got data that you can, man, knock your socks off. So, if you have any more questions and have anything, feel free to come ask one of us. We'll sure try to get you whatever we can, we do. So, be blessed. Let's pray over that real quick. Heavenly Father, we just come in the name of Jesus, and we do by faith, put this at the foot of the cross. Our financial challenges are your financial challenges. So we know you can handle them better than we can. So guide us and lead us and teach us and instruct us and love us. We thank you. And we thank you for what you're going to do in this church. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen.
Thanks. There you go. Get her all balanced out. I want to say a word of prayer too before we begin. Father, thank you for the reports that we've received this morning, both those that are written and those that have been spoken. It is obvious, Father, that you have been faithful, absolutely faithful to us through this past year. Through the past many years that this congregation has existed, we have never, ever defaulted, not financially or spiritually. Even though we've gone through difficult, very difficult times, you have walked us through it. And we're very, very thankful. Father, we don't have the ability to read the future. But you have known all things from the beginning of time. And there is nothing that takes place here today or will take place in the future that you didn't know about long ago. And that gives us a great sense of security and comfort, Father. I was just thinking about that in Sunday school this morning as we talked about how you are able to take all of the junk of our lives and somehow accomplish your purposes in spite of us. And then turn around and give us places of honor and blessing in your plan and in your kingdom. How are we to understand such love and such grace, such humility, such patience? So, Father, as we think about the new year, that's just a human measurement of time. We don't even know how to define time, really. It just is. But we know that time will pass and events will take place. Things will change. People will come to Christ. Christians will grow. Others will be lost. We don't know who will die and who will live in the coming year. So our trust is in you. Our confidence is in you. But there are some givens. There are some very stable, unmovable truths that we can know and we can rest our lives on. We thank you for that. Now, Lord, help us to think through this study today and hear what your Spirit has to say. In Jesus' name, amen. In anticipation of today's meeting and message, it falls to me and has historically fallen to me to somehow try to give us a perspective for the new year. Because of the difference in our gifts and the way we think and approach ministry, I'm very, very grateful that Philip and Harvey are involved as elders, because they are what I am not, and I am what they are not. And together we sharpen each other and are able to bring perspective that none of us would have on our own. And that's why I asked Philip to speak last Sunday and to bring you a perspective of the mission and the vision that God has given us as he perceives it and is able to articulate that to us. But how am I to speak? What, Lord, is it that your people need to hear from me today? And so I have prepared notes, but the last few days, this is what's been constantly cycling through my mind. And I believe that it's foundational. So let me just share it with you. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, our Lord. She is his new creation by water and the Word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. elect from every nation, yet one or all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses, with every grace endued. God bless Samuel Wesley. The hymn goes on and talks about our eternal hope. You have heard us say, well, before I say that, let me say this. I don't know that anything I could say would be more profound or more eloquent than what I just read to you. It is absolutely true that no matter what we human beings plan and propose, whatever mission or vision that we come up with in our prayerful thoughts, no matter what happens to the local congregation, whether it grows large or stays small, whether it is effective or not effective in carrying out the mission, it is nevertheless an absolute truth. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ our Lord. And every one of our lives have to be built on that reality. And what we do as a congregation has to be built on that reality. If it's not, then it doesn't matter what we do, it has no eternal value. You've heard us say many times that Jesus commanded with all authority in heaven and on earth to go and make disciples of all nations. The Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28. The work of our leaders, you saw them stand here among us today. The work of our leaders has been to teach and equip each Christian to be more effective in carrying out the mission that God lays on all of us individually and all of us collectively. We take that responsibility seriously. During the year of 2016, the elders have worked together diligently to provide meaningful opportunities for equipping you in ministry. One of those is going on right now. We're coming into our fourth week of learning how to study the Bible and interpret it accurately and correctly. 28 people have been in that class. That's not to discredit anybody that's not in that class. It's just to say, this is the kind of thing that we take seriously. The Bible is the Word of God, but we have to understand it. We have to be able to read it and get to the truth that's there. This is one equipping opportunity that is just one of many. And if you read through the report and you get into the pastor's and the elders' report, I listed a whole bunch of stuff in there that has taken place in the past year and some that preceded the year. I won't take time to read all that report, but what I do want to do is to take us back to our mission statement. We've had it hanging on the wall over there for about 22 years. The ladies that made that, I don't think any of them are still with us. There may be someone that is. And sometimes I've thought and suggested it would be nice to have some new banners. So, you know, a fresh look at our mission statement, to know Him and to make Him known. That mission statement is not unique with us. There are many ministries, not the least of which YWAM. YWAM, Youth with a Ministry, Youth with a Mission, a large ministry across the world has that as their mission statement. But it succinctly expresses our mission. Let me take you to John 17, verses 1 through 3. Jesus was approaching his death. This perhaps occurred, most likely occurred, the night of the Last Supper, the night before he was crucified. But he prayed for his disciples. And in the opening verses of that prayer, he said this: Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all peoples, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life. Now I want you to get this. Don't miss this. This is eternal life. That they may know you. To know him. That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. That's why that is in our mission statement. To know him. Let me take you over to Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. The Apostle Paul, writing to Christians in the city of Colossae, which was up in that area we know as Turkey today. He writes this. He's praying for them. He's telling them what he's praying for them. Now, you men get little emails from me most mornings that's labeled "My prayer for you today." That's what Paul was doing with the Colossians. He's saying, "This is what I'm praying for you." And he says in it, "For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you." And now he's going to say what he's praying for them. "Asking God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord, and may please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God." Growing in the knowledge of God. The first and most fundamental need and joy of every human being, Christian or not, is to know Him. Knowing God is not an exercise in superstition or self-deception. When we say we can know God, we can personally know Him. People who are not spiritual, people who do not have the Holy Spirit within them, have no idea what we're talking about. How can you know someone who is invisible, doesn't speak to you? You can't touch him. You can't have dinner with him. You know, I mean, people don't understand because their thinking is all carnal, fleshly, of this world. But when we come into Christ, the very beginning, the very first thing is we come to realize we can know Him. He's not some mysterious, withdrawn, unknowable deity. He is a very personal God who has gone to the extreme lengths to make sure that we have every opportunity to personally know Him. Knowing God is... The word that came to my mind as I was thinking about this was, knowing God is axiomatic. It's a given. Knowing God is a given for Christians, for children of God. We can never know absolute truth unless we know Him, because He is the seat and authority of all truth. We can never know ourselves or the world around us in reality unless we know God. We can never satisfy the deepest longings of the human soul unless we know God. Knowing God is the quest of every human being. Look at the world around us. Look at all the different directions people are going, to the extreme of things like what we see ISIS doing, just to try to know God. I mean, we think of these people as brutal, insane, homicidal maniacs. That's not true. Well, it may be true in the sense that Satan has driven them to this point, but they think they are seeking God with all their hearts in an uncompromising way. They're wrong. They don't know God. And they will never find Him. What they will find as they pursue, and this is true of every human being who pursues another path, they will find that when they finally look upon the face of their God, it is the devil himself. And by then, it's too late. God is absolutely knowable. One of the tragedies of the church is that I'm convinced there are many, many Christians who do not know God, who don't even know that they can know God. God has revealed Himself to us through creation, through supernatural visitation, through the incarnation of His Son, and all who will receive Jesus can know God. Jesus told the disciples, if you know Me, you know the Father. And finally, God reveals Himself to us in His Holy Spirit that indwells us, and through His divinely inspired Word, the Bible, and in prayer. It's the first and passionate purpose of God's people, you and me, to know Him and to always know Him more. This is the interesting thing about God. He is not that different from we human beings in this respect. Terry and Cynthia have been married for 50 years. We had our 50th anniversary last year. Some of you have been married longer than that. I know. The Warnke's here. Let me ask you a question. Do you ever really get to know one another 100%? Or is there always something more to know? Honestly, my wife amazes me. How can we live in the relationship of marriage for 51 or 2 years or whatever it's been, because I can't even remember that anymore. How can we do that and still learn things about each other that we didn't know? Listen, you will never plumb the depths of the person of Almighty God. There's always more to know. And my testimony to you is that when you learn those things, it is a joy unspeakable. It is like, oh wow, what a great God. What a wonderful God we have. What a blessed Father we have. I didn't know that about Him. Because when we learn things about Him, it's always good. It's always good. Sometimes in marriage, we learn things about each other that aren't so good. Well, Connie does. I always learn good things about her. It is the first and passionate purpose of the church, God's people, to know Him, always to know Him more. And that it should be your pursuit. I'm going to tell you what, you cannot get to know God if you don't talk to Him, if you don't spend time with Him, if you don't seek Him. He said, if you will seek me with all your heart, you will find me. And I will be found by you. That should be a driving passion in our lives. It's not just a motto on the hanging on the wall. It's what we're all about as God's people. While it's not written in our mission statement, I wanted to bring one other factor in here. Knowing God makes it possible for us to know who we are. Understanding our identity is one of the driving forces of every human being. First to know God, but then to know who we are. And you can get all kinds of answers in the world of academia and science and social sciences. Who are we? Where did we come from? Where are we going? Were we originally just a smattering of chemicals that somehow came together and crawled out of the sludge and after a few million years, here we are? What are we? Where are we going when it's all over? If it's true that we're created by God, and we believe it is, then our identity is just exactly who He says we are. He created us. We're His. He knows who we are. And He tells us who we are. There are many statements in the Bible that help us understand our identity. We read about we are created in the image of God. He recreates in us the image of His dear Son, and so on and so forth. But in both the Old and New Testament, God divides people into two groups, and we can find different labels for that in the Scriptures. But today I want to talk about believers and unbelievers. Genesis 15:6. Abram believed the Lord, and He credited it to him as righteousness. John 3:17-18. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Or the Apostle Paul writing to Timothy, 1 Timothy 4:12, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, in purity. Two kinds of people, believers and unbelievers. Believers know and obey God because they know His Word, and His Word is true. And when we obey it, it brings blessing. Unbelievers believe whatever and do what they want in ignorance of God, following and pursuing all kinds of deceptions and personal opinions, thrashing around in the dark, looking for something that makes sense, often in defiance of the true and living God. We who are in Christ are characterized as believers. In the New Testament books, from Matthew through Acts, Christians are known as disciples. You hear us talk a lot about, want to make disciples, want to make disciple makers, we want to be disciples, Well, it's common in the first century for Jewish rabbis to have a group of students that were in training, and they would follow that rabbi around, they would learn from him, they would seek to emulate him and his lifestyle, and they were being equipped in the knowledge of God as the rabbi understood it. So it was a common term to describe believers who would follow Jesus. And so He said in the Great Commission, all authority in heaven and earth is given to me. Therefore, go into all the world and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and lo, I'm always with you to the end of the age. Go and make disciples. So Christians are disciples. We are believers, and we're followers of Jesus. We're students of Jesus. So when Jesus gave the commission to bring the good news of the forgiveness of sin and eternal life through the belief in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, He calls those people, we people, disciples. And that's what we are, learners and followers of Jesus. But from the book of Acts through the book of Revelation, we see another label that is pretty common. They are known as brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters. When we come into Christ, we come into a familial relationship, a family relationship. Jesus declares we are His true family, even more real than flesh and blood. Matthew 12:49-50, Jesus points to His disciples and He says, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my mother, brother, and sister." Listen to me. Church membership does not make us members of the family of God. Obeying Jesus is the qualifying term. The early church lived out that identity all through the New Testament. Tragically, it's rare to find a group of Christians that actually believe that their family relationships in Christ are more real than their flesh and blood relatives. But all through the Bible, we believers, the disciples of Jesus, are taught to honor and respect the sacred relationship that was purchased by His blood. Our identity as saints is one that many Christians don't even know about. A lot of confusion about the saints. And yet this term is used often from the book of Acts on down through the book of Revelation. It doesn't mean that it doesn't occur in Matthew through Acts. The word saints doesn't occur there. It occurs after that through the epistles of the apostle as he is ministering to the churches. It doesn't mean that we're no longer disciples and now we're saints. It means that the apostle is bringing a new dimension of emphasis to our identity in Christ. The word translated saints simply means holy ones. Holy ones. Do you ever consider yourself to be holy? I find it hard to think about myself as a holy person, knowing the corruption of my sinful nature. And yet that's what He calls us. He says we are holy ones. Well, it's not our ability to do everything right that makes us holy. It's the forgiveness of sin and the righteousness of Jesus Christ that's been imputed to us because our sins have been forgiven. Our sins were laid on Him, and He laid His righteousness on us. A divine transfer took place. An imputation, if you will. God imputed our sins to Jesus and imputed Jesus' righteousness to us. So, we now have... in our identity, the holiness of Jesus Christ. It's real, my friends. It's not imaginary. It's not some kind of theological hocus pocus. We live holy lives as Jesus is more and more formed within us in a world that is very unholy. I want to read the rest of that prayer that Paul was praying for the Colossians, because I think it's helpful at this point to help us get a handle on this. In verse 9, chapter 1, verse 9, he says, "For this reason, since the day we heard about you, We have not stopped praying for you and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God. You see, He's talking about that holiness, that righteousness, that obedience. Being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in whom, in the kingdom of light. How did He do that? How were you and I qualified to share in the inheritance of the saints? For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sin. Amen. I hope you will grant me grace to continue on. I realize that the time is up. But I need to finish this. If someone needs to leave, you will not be criticized. We understand. An even more amazing identity is given to us in the New Testament, and that is similar to the family relationship, brother, sister, mother, and that is sons and daughters of God. Galatians 3:26, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, for you, all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. Or in John 1:12 and 13, yet to all who received Him, to those who believed in His name, you gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural ascent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. And so we have a relationship here where Jesus is the Son of God. We are His brothers and sisters. That makes us sons and daughters of God as well. This is an amazing reality, my friends. We need to see ourselves for who we are in Christ. To be a son or daughter of God means that we qualify for the inheritance that belongs to Jesus. This is our identity. Believers, disciples, brothers and sisters, saints, sons and daughters. We know God because we believe. We follow Jesus, learning from Him. We share as equals in His family. We live out the holy lives that He is forming in us. And we share in the inheritance of the children of God. It doesn't get any better than that, my friends. Well, it does eventually when we get there. But here and now, that's who we are. Now, the final statement in our mission statement over here is to make Him known. It is an unimaginable privilege God has given us to participate in the revelation of Himself to people by sharing our own knowledge of Him. That's really God's agenda for us. Once we come to Christ, once we know Him, and we are growing, and Christ is being formed in us more and more, day after day, as we seek Him with all our hearts, He gives us something meaningful and honorable to do, and that is to share what we know of Him with others, what He has done for us. And that happens all over the world, even in places where terrifying persecution takes place. The revelation of God still shines through the lives of His people. The cost is great. Terry and Cynthia are making a great sacrifice to go do what God has called them to do, but from a human perspective. The cost is great. It will cost you something. It will cost me something if we take up the mantle of making Him known. But the reward is out of this world. It is amazing what God can do. If we truly understand who we are and who the people are around us, We will be driven to pray for them, to be drawn to God. We have the greatest news they could ever hear. If they don't turn to Him and believe in Jesus, they're going to spend an eternity without God. And the wrath that He poured out on Jesus on the cross, they'll have to bear for themselves because they didn't accept Jesus. What a tragedy for anyone to have to pay for their own sins when Jesus has already paid for it for us. So we pray and we reach out to unbelievers, sharing the gospel, including our own personal testimony, building relationships with people, which becomes a bridge over which this most personal and intimate and powerful information can pass, the knowledge of God. Listen to me, church events are minimally effective in bringing people to Jesus Christ. The most that can happen is we can share the love of Christ and people will be drawn to His love. But we can have, there was a time when I was a kid that we could have a 2-week revival and many people would give their lives to Jesus. That day is pretty well past. If we had a 2-week revival, I suspect you would not be here. We just don't have time for that every night for 2 weeks. We're busy people. That's not an indictment. It's a statement of the reality of the times we live in. And the people of this world certainly don't have time for it. So church events are minimally effective when it comes to reaching people for Christ. But personal caring and sharing works. But it takes an investment. We have to be willing to make that investment. The gospel was never meant to be shared in a vacuum or in academia. The gospel was meant to be shared personally, bringing people into the community of faith, the family of God, to be a brother, a sister, to share in the inheritance of the saints, to be sons and daughters of Almighty God. This is who we are, my friends. In relationship with God, we know. And we need to remember it. And this is the mission He's called us to. That's what this church is all about. I started out saying, I don't know what the future lies. I don't know what's going to happen. We sit in staff meetings and elders meetings and ministry team leaders meetings and we plan and we pray and we strategize and we come up with ideas and some ideas work and some ideas don't. Some of them work for a while and then they have to be changed because they don't work. They only work for a while. I don't know. We seek for the Holy Spirit to lead us and take. It's like one brother said one time, God can strike a mighty blow with a crooked stick. Well, I'm a crooked stick, I can tell you for sure. And if anything ever happens because of my activity, it's not because I was good, it's because He's good. And the same thing is true of you. But you know the amazing thing is, He does it. He takes His crooked stick and He strikes a mighty blow. He can use broken people. He can use people who feel inadequate and insecure. He can use people who don't know what to say, who fear that they're going to be asked a question and they won't have an answer. He can use people like that. He can use people that are busy. He can use people that don't have anything to do. He can use old people and young people. He can use anyone who is willing, yielded to Him, seeking to know Him, willing to make Him known. We're going to bring it to a conclusion. Have I covered everything? Yes. Okay. Come, guys. Let's do the music and wrap it up. Carolyn, would you like to say something?